Let's close eyes. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you, we praise you for this wonderful day, O Lord. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together in this place. As we are gathered over here in your name, O Lord Jesus, we believe that you are in our midst. Your Holy Spirit is here with us, in us, and upon us. Lord, we thank you, we praise you for all your goodness, for all your kindness and your mercy, which endures forever. Lord, as we begin this day, help us to surrender our lives, our thoughts, our desire, our will into your hands and depend on your will for us and depend on your desire, what you have for us. There are a lot of things going in our mind, in our heart, O Lord, and we don't know what to choose, where to go and what to do. But it is your word and your only word, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, who comforts us, who strengthens us. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for your unconditional love. As we begin with these teachings, O Lord, help us to focus and to remain in that word what we learned today. Lord, many a times we think it is people, it is a friends, it is a colleague, it is a preacher who is helping, who is strengthening us in all the areas of our life. But it's not them, but it is your word through them which is comforting us, which is strengthening us. Let that word grow in our heart, which will bring a multiple harvest in our lives, O Lord. Holy Spirit, take complete control of this teaching. Let it be done according to your will. You take control of this moment, of this time, and this teaching, O Lord, because you know what we need exactly, what we are going through in our lives. As we sit here this day and study your word, we surrender all the things of our lives into your hands, O Lord. Let your word mold us. Let your word teach us and help us, Lord, to remain abide in you so that we, the branches, could produce a good fruit. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. What is the reason why we began to study the word or to go for the retreat or to, you know, continue in the word? Why is that? किद्याक आम्ही एक प्रश्न विचारता, ओके, किद्याक म्हणून आम्ही आमच्या लायफान एक डिसिजन घेता, आम्ही देवाचे उतर ऐकूंक जाय, ओ रितीराक वचूंक जाय, कोणी आमकां सांगता न्हू रिट्रीट हा, यू ऑल अंडरस्टँड कॉन्कन यू नो, सो वेन समबडी टेल्स अस ओ दॅट प्लेस द रिट्रीट्स आर हॅपनिंग वाय डोंट यू गो अँड देन वी टेक अ डिसिजन टू गो, वाय इज दॅट? सो दॅट या आय कॅन मूव राईट to know the word of God, okay,
and healing
for healing, okay, okay,
To live according to the word,
to live according to the word, okay,
wisdom of God, wisdom,
to get a wisdom of God, okay, yes, yes, sister, you said something else, to get the solution for our problems, okay, then to know more of God, okay. What about you? You are coming from where? Now you have to give me answer. Yeah, tell me, what is the reason? You come all the way from Benjim, yes or no?
Yeah.
Ah, then yeah. What makes you to come to this place? To this place or any place where the word is being preached?
To learn more.
To learn more, yes.
Yeah. Change my life.
To change your life, okay. And? यू आन्सर तू कितें म्हणटा तुमी खंयच्यान येता खंयच्यान येयला तुमी आ दारगळे सो एवरी वीक यू आर कमिंग आय सी यू ऑन द पिक्चर्स ओके तो एवरी वीक तुम्ही येता कित्याक लागून तुम्ही येता म्हणजे कितें तुमच्या मनान कितें तुमचो रिझन येवपाक टू रिन्यू आवर माइंड ओके कुछ प्रॉब्लम होता है तो व्हाट अबाउट यू ये लेके आई है ना साथ में वो लेके आई है ना ऐसा है लेके आई है उसको कैन मेक आउट ओके ओके प्रेज गॉड सो वी हर्ड लॉट डिफरेंट डिफरेंट आंसर्स फ्रॉम डिफरेंट डिफरेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू फ्रॉम आवर अंडरस्टैंडिंग यस द मेन रीजन वुड बी द हीलिंग because we have problems which is yes. Because when I started my journey when I started to go for the retreat the first reason the main reason what I have is for my benefit the reason why I had attended the first time retreat in my life is my benefit correct wisdom you said
yeah.
without wisdom we cannot understand the word of god yes or no but to get that wisdom also I need to have a desire to know him more If I don't get to know him, I will not experience that wisdom upon me. Sajmata, wisdom is what in Konkani is Anvai. Samaj, okay? To understand the word of God, to get the wisdom from God, I need to have, what you call this? Ami devache utar, devache utarak ami janna jazage zagyanchar hoita. The first thing it should be, that I have to know my God. Correct, no? Now, for example, we have children, right? Now, children, when they come to parents, they say, Mama, I want this. Mama, I want that. And nothing more than that. And they take what they want and they go. They don't even stop to say, Mama, I love you, that you cook this food for me. They don't say. For example, huh? So father sometimes, if the children goes to school, and when they goes to school, when they see something in the school like some other friends are getting a different kind of pencil or different kind of book or different kind of a bag or water bottle or anything when the child see that immediately the child is thinking I will go home and I will go to my father and I will ask him exactly same thing I want what my friend is having correct so the reason the child is coming to the father is not the love but is the thing what my friend is having I want need okay so when he comes now when father says okay I will give is it because the father wants to fulfill everything what he wants or it's the love it's the love correct but there are two different thinking the child is coming to a father because he needs something but the father is giving out of love understanding now the reason when I ask the question I don't know that I would be asking this question. I really did not know, but it just came. Thank you, Holy Spirit, because that's how he is giving. How to start the teaching or where to go? Because I did not know what to start and what to say, because all we have to depend is on Him. Correct? No, not with our strength, with our mind, but depending on His wisdom and His knowledge. Correct? So, okay. For them, I'll have to translate in Konkani. Okay. जेन्ना आमी आता प्रश्न विचारलो कितें यू रियली अंडरस्टँड कोंकणी सच में कोंकणी आती है ना कोंकणी समज तो आती है उसको कोंकणी तुझें नाव कितें येता तेका ओके जेन्ना आमी आता ही इज युअर ब्रदर ब्रदर नाव दीस सिस्टर इज कमींग हियर फ्रॉम वेरी लॉंग ही भयण आमची खूब टायमांच्यान येता येता न्हू खूब टायमांच्यान येता सो शी हर्ड द वर्ड ऑफ गॉड शी अंडरस्टूड द लव ऑफ गॉड शी अंडरस्टूड द बेनिफिट ऑफ बींग इन द वर्ड ऑफ गॉड शी अंडरस्टूड वॉट शी इज रिसिवींग इन द वर्ड ऑफ गॉड आतां ही भयण देवाचें उतर हांगा आयकूंक येता देवाचें उतर आयकून तिच्या लायफान जायते चेंजीस जाल्या जावंक ना खूब चेंजीस जाल्या आतां तिच्या लायफान जे चेंजीस जाल्या शी वॉन्ट डेट चेंजीस हॅपन इन हीज इन हर ब्रदर लायफ एज वेल करेक्ट आतां ती ह्या भावाक हांगा घेवन येयला आतां त्या भावाक हांगा घेवन येयला आतां भावाच्या मनान कितें आहा भयण घेवन येयल्या खंय हाडला गाय आपणाक जातालें मनान जाता न्हू लसपाचें ना वी आर फ्रेंड्स हियर आमी फ्रेंडा ओके वी आर फ्रेंड्स आय एम नॉट समन स्पेशल सेम लायक यू आमी हांव तुमच्याच भशेन सो आतां ही भयण ह्या भावाक घेवन आयला कितें सांगून यो तूं कितें तरी प्रॉब्लम्स आसतलो जावं वॉट एवर सिट्युएशन इज हॅपनींग कितें तरी आसतलें लायफान. सो दीस सिस्टर हॅज कॉल्ड द ब्रदर यू कम वीथ मी. सो आयज ती घेवन येयल्या. आतां हो बाब हांगासर येयला कितें चिंतून, कित्याक लागून तरी भयण घेवन येयला, प्रॉब्लम्स ऑर वॉट एवर. सो ही मस्ट बी थिंकींग, ही इज वंडरींग नाव वॉट्स गोइंग टू हॅपन नेक्स्ट. बट दी ओनली थिंग वॉट वी आर स्टडींग ओवर हियर इज द वर्ड ऑफ गॉड. आमकां कोणें रचल्या, आमकां कोणें रचला, किसने बनाया हम लोगों को, बसता किसने बनाया, परमेश्वर ने, करेक्ट ना. कभी हम लोगों आमी केन्ना तरी चिंतला की आमकां देवान कित्याक रचला, कित्याक रचला आमकां, वाय गॉड हॅज क्रिएटेड अस, टू लव हिम, टू सर्व हिम, इन अ वे टू हॅव अ फेलोशीप विथ हिम or to have a relationship with him. Yes or no?
Yes.
When children are born, we want children, right?
Right.
When we get married, we want children. Why do we want children? To serve us? If we say God created us to serve him, so what about us as a human being? When we have children, does the children, do we expect children to serve us?
No.
Amche kuidat korpak lagon amka jay burgi. Some people did. I was about to say that. When God created us, he did not create us only to serve him. Serving him in what way we will serve him? What is the meaning of serving God? What is the meaning of serving God? What do we do for God?
See, serving God means when you serve your brother and sister.
But are we doing that? I don't know.
To certain
extent. Are we doing that?
Not 100%.
So if it is not 100%, it means little leaven is there, right?
Yes.
But in the eyes of the Lord, even little leaven is there, little yeast is there, it's not acceptable. Correct, no? Hallelujah. So I am getting here now, Konkani English or what? I don't know. Hallelujah. Kine korum? Konkani korum? Also? Full Konkani I'll go. Yeah, no? ओके. सो देवान जेन्ना आमकां रोचला, आमकां कित्याक लागून रोचला देवान, आपल्याचे मोहिमेक रोचला. येस ओ नो? फॉर हीज ग्लोरी. बट जेन्ना जेवण देवान आमकां रोचला, देवान आमकां रोचला एक तेज्या देवा बरोबर आमचो संबंद आसपाक. सजमता आमकां हे रिलेशनशीप आमचो संबंद आसपाक देवा सांगता. पूण दिसांतले दिसा आमी कितले फावटी आमकां तो थॉट येता, आमकां ती चिंतना येता की खरेंच रियली दॅट आय एम हॅवींग अ रिलेशनशीप विथ हीम. You know, really I'm having a relationship with God. Do we really think about it in a day? We can say in a day, how many times, like, disatlan, kitle fauti ami devachi yaad korta? We would remember him only when we go through problem. Amka devacho uda sata kenna, jenna amcha kudin, jenna amka pain zata, kenna duk zata, za potta, za kire zata, jenna ami deva gulo korta. Oiva na? But does, pun devan amka kharet rochla, ki jenna amka tras sata, tenna tami deva uda skorpa? Last time when I had come here, I remember I had taken the example of Kumar, a potter. I had taken that example. I don't know whether you all remember. Mama, you was there, right? So, Devan amka rochla, aple moiming, aplo mok kurpak, ani aple sangata ami sombondan raupak. Ata je bashen ami amcha avu bapaycha mok kurta. Korina ami, amcha parentsacha mok ami konna, maabap ka pyaar nahi karte hum log. करते हैं ना. ओके, वेन वी से जेन्ना आमी म्हणटा आमी देवाचो आमच्या पेरंट्साचो मोग करता, आमच्या मायपायचो आवय बापायचो जेन्ना आमी मोग करता, एट वॉट लेवल वी आर लव्हींग देम, हाव वी आर लव्हींग देम, कशे भशेन आमी आमच्या बापायचो मोग करता, ह्युमन लेवल, बट हाव डू वी लव, हाव डू वी शो, या बट देर आर चिल्ड्रन दे रियली लव देम, कंडिशनल लव, कंडिशनल लव. आमी जेन्ना आमच्या पेरंट्साचो आमच्या आवय बापायचो जेन्ना आमी मोग करता, ह्या मोगान कंडिशन्स आहा, मिनींग यू गीव मी, आय वॉन्ट दीस 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 दीस, यू गीव मी, देन आय वील लव यू. नाजाल्यार आमी केन्नाय पळय जेन्ना आमचे पेरंट्स कितें वेन दे कॅनॉट अफोर्ड टू गीव अ समथींग, वॉट डू वी से, आय एम नॉट टॉकिंग टू यू, करेक्ट नो? द चिल्ड्रन वील से रायट, आय एम नॉट टॉकिंग टू यू, आय एम नॉट टॉकिंग टू यू, यू आर नॉट गिविंग मी दीस, यू आर नॉट गिविंग मी दॅट, आय एम नॉट टॉकिंग टू यू. डू वी से दॅट? वी से दॅट. बट वो मोग, is it conditional or is it unconditional?
Conditional.
Is it one sided or double sided?
One sided.
When we put condition, we
one-sided.
When we put a condition is you do something, then I will love you. It's a conditional love. Understanding? Jenna ami amcha parents acha earthly ways I'm saying the earthly love, the human love I can say. संवसारी मोग जेन्ना आसता वो मोग आमी दुसऱ्याचो केन्ना करूंक पावता जेन्ना तूं म्हाका दिता आय लव यू जेन्ना तूं म्हाका बरें करता आय लव यू इफ यू डोंट डू एन्ड इफ यू डोंट गीव मी वॉट आय वॉन्ट आय डोंट लव यू येस ओ नो समटायम्स इवन वी पूट कंडीशन टू अर पार्टनर्स टू अर स्पाउस ऑर टू अर चिल्ड्रन इफ यू डोंट कम टू रिट्रीट आय डोंट लव यू एन्ड आय डोंट बिलीव दॅट यू लव मी येस ओ नो केन्ना भुरग्यांक आमी कंडीशन घालना Suppose if we have children like 17, 18 years old or maybe 15, 16 year old, tenka yog naka rehti rak, okay, to listen the word of God. They doesn't want to come because they're children, no, they want to play, they want to go here and then with the friends. But in that situation, what parents does, you come for the retreat, I will give you this. Do we put a condition? We put right?
Yes.
But is this the way? Is this a godly way?
No.
No. Ami kire munta, you come for the retreat, then only I will believe that you love me. If I want to say you come for the retreat, then only I will believe you love me. Then what about the God's love? Are you understanding?
Yes.
Getting it? So it should not be. Many a times we are telling to our children, supposing if you don't get this marks, I will be very disappointed. Do we say like that to our children?
Yes.
Did we ever said it? We must have said it, right? But expectation we have. You bring this mark. You have to study. Then I will believe that you are really my child. Dialogues, no? In the movies also, they say this kind of dialogues. Unless it is not happening in reality, they would not get those dialogues. Now, because they are doing those dialogues, it must be like, it's happening in the world. Yes or no? You have to do this and then. So, it's conditional. In a short way, we can say the worldly love is a conditional love. But do we ever really understood the love of God? Do we ever really understood the love of God? केन्ना तरी आमी आमच्या जिवितान देवाचो मोग कितें तो आमी समजला काय डू यू हॅव फ्रेंड्स फ्रेंड आसा गूड रिलेशन ओके गूड रिलेशन गोईंग आउटसायड टुगेदर भायर वयता भोंवता वयता न्हू पिकनीक समटायम्स यू ऑल गो मे बी एक दीस केन्नाय तुजो फ्रेंड तुका तूं फोन करता फ्रेंडाक करता सो वन डे यू आर कॉलिंग एंड कॉलिंग ही इज नॉट आन्सरींग युअर कॉल करेक्ट एक दीस तूं फोन मारता तो फ्रेंड तुजो फोन आन्सर करना आनी फोन वेटिंगार येता ओके सो समजता न्हू सो तूं तुज्या फ्रेंडांक फोन करता आनी तुजो फ्रेंड म्हणटा तुजो फ्रेंड द नंबर यू आर कॉलिंग इज ऑन अनादर कॉल ओके टॉकिंग टू समबडी यू आर कॉलिंग एंड कॉलिंग ही इज नॉट आन्सरींग आफ्टर हाफ एन आवर यू आर कॉलिंग द फोन इज रिंगींग आतां तुज्या मनान कितें जाता म्हजो फोन वेटिंगार पडला हेणें म्हाका रिटर्न फोन करूंक ना करेक्ट आतां तुज्या मनान कितें जाता इफ ही कॉल्स मी नाव आय वील नॉट आन्सर Happens?
Yes.
If he calls, it's not only for him, it's for everybody, example, okay? So what happens? We're calling and calling to our friends or colleagues and the phone is coming on waiting. And after half an hour, you're trying again, it's ringing but not answering. Now what you're thinking, oh, the phone was in hand, my missed call has gone there, he must have or she must have seen, but not calling me back. Now what thoughts are coming? What happened? I must have done something wrong. That's why she is or he is not answering. Correct, no? All thoughts are coming in the mind. Yes or no? And now what we are deciding, okay, now when he calls or she calls, I will not answer. Let me show in the same way. So what happens? Revenge. What happens? Revenge. Badla geta. Correct, no? You understand English, right? He understands. So, revenge we take. Correct, no? Amka badla geunza. Tenen kela? Aumi kurta. Did God play this kind of role with us?
No.
If God did not play this kind of role with us, why we are playing like this with others?
Human tendency.
Human tendency? Are you a spirit or do you have a spirit or you are a spirit?
I am a spirit being.
Are you a human being or spirit being?
Human.
You are a human being. Think nicely and then tell. Don't work with your knowledge and intellectual. Human tendency, correct? You said it.
Tendency.
Human tendency. Now, the reason why I am not able to understand the God kind of love is because of my mind. Understanding?
Yes.
If I say I am a human being, I will operate in that human being. But if I believe that I am a spirit being, I will operate in the spirit being. Are you understanding?
Yes.
Let me show you the verse. We don't have scriptures here, no? In Proverbs, in Proverbs 23:7 says, in the book of Proverbs 23:7 says, for as he think in his heart, so is he. As a man, Proverbs 23:7, as a man, you can write down the scripture and then we can we'll study first. As a man think in his heart, so is he. जे किने आमी आमच्या काळजात आमच्या मनात आमी आमचे आमच्या बद्दल आमी चित्ता आमी तेच जाता. इफ आय थिंक दॅट आय एम आय हॅव डन दिस दिस थिंग आय हॅव डन दिस रॉंग आय हॅव कमिटेड अ सिन आय एम अ सिनर आय एम नॉट गुड इनफ 23:7 आय एम नॉट गुड इनफ आय एम दिस इफ आय एम थिंकिंग लाईक दॅट सो आय विल बी. God never created for me to go and think on the negative. But God wants me to speak what God has done for me. Are you understanding? Devan amka rochna amme kide kela te fatle ani ka ugdas korpak nu. Pun devan amka rochna ani devan amka ami munta new life dila in Christ Jesus. Yes or no? Now we are in Christ Jesus. Ata ami Jesus sove ami jieta. Now we are not coming under the old covenant, but we are in the new covenant. Under the new covenant, the Spirit of God is dwelling in me. My body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and God's Spirit is dwelling in me. When I live my life in the consciousness that God's Spirit is dwelling in me, how conscious I will be that I would always thinking about what God has done for me, what God is calling for me. Correct? No, ami kide chitteli dev maka kide munon maka ulo korta God, how he is thinking about me, I will think on that. Whatsoever man think in his heart, so is he. So it's totally depend on what I am thinking about myself. But to think about myself, the good things, I have to know first what God has written about me in his written word. Are you understanding? I will not live my life according to the world standard, but I will live my life according to God's standard, and I will live my life in what God has called me or have said about me. If my God is saying about me that I am a new creature, yes, I am a new creature. If God is saying about me that you are forgiven, yes, I am forgiven. No matter who's coming and taking all my past, you know, and somebody's talking about my past, oh, she was like this before, she was like that before, she did like this, she did like that. For example, about me, it should not affect me because I am not the old person anymore, but now I am a new person. Yes or no? But what you think about yourself, so I will be. I mean, what I think about myself, so I will be. But when I know the word of God, I will think only what God is thinking about me. Am I confusing you?
No.
No, right? So it's totally depend on me how I'm thinking about myself. But to think good things about me, I should know what God has said about me. Yes or no? Now if God is saying that I am forgiven, I am delivered, yes or no? I am set free. Now how I am set free? Through his precious blood. How I am cleansed from my sins? Through his precious blood. So I need to ask a question to myself, am I conscious about his blood on me? Every day when I get up from my bed, am I thinking that blood of Jesus is upon me? Am I saying that I am a spirit being? Am I calling myself that I am forgiven? Am I calling to myself and I am saying, Lord, here I am as an empty vessel, offering my body as a living sacrifice unto you? Do we do that every day when we get up in the morning? No. When we don't do this, Satan is ready to put all the lies in my mind. He is ready there near the doorstep, just waiting for you to get up, and then he will give you all kinds of thoughts. And when I receive those thoughts, what happens? I will begin to ponder and begin to think on those negative thoughts which he is giving me. And then what happens? Whatsoever man think in his heart, so is he. If the Satan coming and telling me, today you are feeling sick, go and sleep, what I'll do? I'll go to sleep. It means what? I accepted what lies he had given me and I'm going to sleep with taking that lies. And now what happening? In my heart also I'm thinking that I am sick. That whatsoever I think in my heart, in my mind, so I will be. So it's not that, oh, see, I was thinking that I was feeling sick. I'm really sick now. You know why it happened? Because I've received the message and I've accepted and I believed it. Are you understanding? See, if the devil is giving you that you are sick, did God said I am sick? What God said, you are healed, no?
Yes.
What God said, you are healed. But what the devil is telling, you are sick. So am I going to accept what God has said or am I going to accept what devil has given? Now what devil is giving to me, what the Satan is giving to me, the negative thoughts that I am sick, that is, physically you could feel it. For example, maybe you get pain in your ankle and you could not walk. Suddenly when you step out from your bed and now you're trying to walk, you feel the pain. Yes or no? Now when you feel the pain, suddenly you will go and you will sit. Yes or no? You will sit and you will think, why this pain is come? What I have done? Did I, dash my leg somewhere in my sleep or something like that? The thoughts will come. It means what? Why the thoughts will come? Yeah, the thought is come already and now I am meditating on that thought where there is a pain. Why the pain is there? How I got it? When I got it? I'm thinking on that instead of thinking that God has already healed me. Now, if the word of God is not rooted in my heart that I'm already healed, then what will happen? I will take the thought what devil is given me and the physical evidence is there where I have a pain and I will not even think of commanding the pain to leave my body right now. Yes or no? Did God has given us the authority?
Yes.
Yes or no? So when the pain is come, am I supposed to go and sit on the bed and think how it came, when it will go, how it will go, do I have to go to a doctor, do I have to put this ointment, that ointment, and lot of other things. Yes or no? Do I have to take a painkiller because today I have to go somewhere, a very urgent work and this pain is not letting me to step out of the house, all of these thoughts, right? So I am thinking lot of other things, but failing to understand that the word of God says that you are already healed. Are you getting it? And it is so softly and so smoothly will happen, you know, we will not even realize the devil has taken us away. You know, it's like a wave. Have you seen when things are falling into the sea, in the seashore or in the river, let's say the coconut, maybe coconut fall, it will go inside, it will float, right? So when it floats on the water, is the coconut in its control or the waves are taking him wherever? Yes or no? When the word is not rooted in my heart, I am like that coconut, you know, the devil is taking me wherever he wants to take it. But if the word is rooted in my heart, he cannot do anything. Because the moment the thoughts are coming, the pain is coming, God has given me the authority and I am supposed to use that authority being as a Christian or being in Christ Jesus. Yes or no? When we say, I am in Christ Jesus, many a time we say, I am in the word, I am in the word. Oh, really? I am in the word? When the problems come, what are the words coming out from my mouth? That is a question. I might say that I am in the word. I might say I'm in Christ. I might say I go to the retreat every day. I might say I'm preaching the word of God. Even though we are preaching the word of God, even though I'm every day listening to the word of God, does that mean the word is rooted in my heart? Not really. And how will I know? I will know in what fruits I'm producing. Am I forgiving people when somebody come against me? Am I letting go things and keeping my ego aside and letting the love of God flow in my life? That matters. Can I let go things or I'm holding the ego? I would be in the word of God, but when somebody does something, I want to prove my point. I want to prove that I am right, you are wrong. Yes or no? Many times we get stuck in that situation. But I want to prove I did not do it. Why you are blaming me? Happens when neighbor is coming and doing something for us and then the problem goes somewhere ahead and both of us we are called. Then what happens? We try to justify ourselves. But did God really call us to justify ourselves?
Yeah.
Are you getting it? So being in the word of God, to say is easy, but to really act on the word of God it's really easy. It's not difficult. If it was difficult, right, God would have not given us this kind of task. Do we give difficult things to our children? So do you think God has given us something difficult? Even to say I am in the word is easy, and even to say I am standing firm on the word of God, and not say but act on the word of God, is also easy. And that happens only when I become God conscious. That will be only easy for me when I shift my focus on the word of God, when I shift my focus on his love for me and not my love for him. I cannot love him the way he loved me. I can only imitate, but not exactly the same how he loved me. The day I can do that, I can call myself God. But no, just the way he loved me, I can imitate him, but not 100% how much he loved me. Because his love, the only love, is unconditional love. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Are you understanding? The thing what we have to learn from the word, the best example what we can take is the life of Jesus, how he lived for his father's will. Yes or no? Now, do you think that we are in this planet earth is just for no reason? Can we say that we are here just for no reason? Oh, I can earn good money, I can study good good studies and become something, and become engineer and become doctor and become advocate and become teachers and lawyers and all of those things. Do you think God called me only for that? God has a plan and purpose for each one of us life. Whatever would be the position of mine in this world would be the part of it. But that's not the only thing. Just the way God has a plan and purpose for Jesus' life, in the same way God has a plan and purpose for each one of us life. Hallelujah. Now, when Jesus came to this planet earth, the disciples even thought that he came to get the Romans were ruling that time Israel. Yes or no? The Romans were ruling on Hebrews, correct? So these people thought he came to set Jesus came to deliver them from the hands of Roman. They were thinking in that way because of their carnal thinking. Hallelujah. But did Jesus come for that? No. But they thought, when Jesus was talking about the kingdom and kingdom of God or kingdom, they thought that Jesus is talking about their kingdom, where Jesus is come to deliver them out from the hands of Romans. Hallelujah. But it was not that. Because the Bible clearly said, our fight is not with the flesh and blood. It's with the enemy. It's in the unseen. It's not the natural. The more I began to practice, the more I began to study the world, which is the unseen world, the more the word of God is going to be real to me. Now, my thinking is become limited. You know why? Because I believe in my physical eyes. Yes or no? Whatever I see in my eyes, that's my world. Yes or no? Whatever we see with our physical eyes, for us it looks like, okay, this is my world, this is my family, this is my children, and this is my boundaries. I cannot step out from that because I don't have time. Do we say that? We say that sometimes. Yes or no? When we are living with our physical senses, we are thinking, whatever I see, that is my boundaries, and this is my world. Nobody can come in, nobody can go out. Correct? This is what we are thinking. But it's not like that. According to the word of God, it's beyond that. Because the Bible says the seen thing is temporal and the unseen thing is eternal. Are you understanding? So God did not call us to get perish, but he called us to live eternally in a spiritual realm, in a spirit world. Yes or no? Now, when I try to understand the things with my physical understanding, it will look like, the word of God will not make me any sense. Okay, can we go to John? We'll go to John 3:16. If you have your own Bible, you all can open.
In fact, Proverbs 27, the thing about the one he said.
It's in the KJV. KJV, you can go translation.
For he is like one who is inwardly reckoning.
KJV, you go. Yeah. Okay, John 3:16, I will read it for you, okay? Pay attention, huh?
John 3:16.
Yes. Very easy scripture, no? Even small children, they would know this. Correct?
Yes.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Very easy. Okay, we'll read it. For God so loved the world. Yes or no?
Yes.
God so loved the world. God so loved the world means, are you included in that world?
Yes.
So did he love you?
Yes.
Yes or no? So how he proved his love for us? How he proved his love for us? Sacrificing his only son. What sacrifice his son gave? Dying on the cross. When he died on the cross, what did he take of mine on the cross? All my sins. And did Jesus said, when as I have taken all your sins and nailed it on the cross, now you can go on sinning again, that after a few years I will come back again to die on the cross to take your sins?
No. He said,
is it like that?
No.
So he said, Jesus has taken all our sins, all our sickness, all our problems, all our, you know, everything which is not from the kingdom of God, he has nailed it in the on the cross. Yes or no? And now he declared us, we are set free. We are forgiven. Yes or no? But when he said you are forgiven, did he say now you can go on sinning?
No.
But do we sin?
Yes.
Why do we sin?
Because we believe the devil.
We?
Believe the devil.
How long you are going to believe now devil and continue and living in sin? How long?
Sometimes we continue.
But do you do we think that we have more time? First of all, we need to understand that we are in the end time. We don't know that moment when the second coming of Christ will come. It could happen right now within second. We don't know. But are we ready? Are we ready? Are you getting it? We are the old covenant. At least they have a hope that Savior will come and save us. Yes or no? But now, when the Savior will come, he will not come to save anymore, but he will come to judge. Come to judge.
Yeah.
So this is the time what we have is to prepare ourselves. Are you getting it? The time from now, from the time Jesus has already died on the cross, resurrected from the dead, and now he's sitting at the right hand side of the Father. From that time till the time of his second coming, this time is a mercy time. Are you getting it? This time is a mercy time. He wants all of us to repent and change our thinking and to change our ways and to follow his word and to obey his command. Are you getting it? So because we are lost in this world, we are thinking it's okay. God has put us in this world. It's okay if I enjoy a little bit. What is there? But that little enjoyment is going to spoil our life and taking us away from the Lord. Are you getting it? Are you understanding? So there is no more time left for us. Whatever time we get, and this time is a beautiful time. You know why? Because in this time, we know that God has forgiven me and given me a new life. Because I am a new creature. Yes, sir. Okay.
She knows that she's doing wrong, but how she will come to a realization that she has to stop?
She.
Yeah.
Okay. It would depend. I would say that it would be depend on my action. I would say it's depend on my action. You know why? There are two people. Okay, I'll give you my example. Okay. When I started in the Word of God, okay, everybody understood our question. When somebody is still continuing. How they'll get to know that, you know, we are forgiven and she has to stop.
Yeah.
Okay. When I started my journey into the Word of God, I was very excited and I wanted my family also to know about the Word of God. Okay. I wanted them to know what I got to know. And I wanted them also to get that same fire. Okay. What I received, and I was super excited. And I came home from the retreat, and I started to tell them, you know, the Word says this, the Word says that. And so excited. You know what kind of look they gave me? Can you please stop and work it on yourself? That was the reaction I got. And then I got disappointed and I was thinking, Lord, you gave me some secret and I'm going on revealing it to everybody, especially from my family. And you know, through Brother Johnson, through Papa's mouth, he told me, you work on yourself and don't go and try to change other people. You change yourself. When people will see, your family will see change in you, they will begin to realize how come this person is totally transformed. They will begin to understand, they will begin to realize, and they would wonder how this person is changed. How there are so wonderful change, drastic change took place in her. When that happens, no, you see how the Lord works. Because if you go immediately without even you not understanding the word 100%, and that was the first excitement, you know, when the seed is falling on the rocky ground, the example we take, you know, sower and the seed is falling on the rocky ground, they are super excited in the beginning, and when little pressure comes, little persecution comes, it's gone. So I was super excited because that seed has fallen on the rocky ground and it was sprouted. And I did not know at that time the sower and the seed. And Papa said to me, you give time and you study the word. You change yourself. And I was also behind my husband. You come. You see, listen to the word of God. He said, you go. Don't tell me to come. You go. In the beginning. And then when I understood, I stopped calling him. I stopped telling anybody. But I started to feed myself. The more I used to feed myself, the more calmer I started to become. The more patient, the patience started to grow in me. The calmness started to grow in me. You know, that love started to flow in me. And then one day came a day, and then I started to pray for him. Saying what? The Spirit of the Lord, very simple prayer. The Spirit of the Lord is upon him. My God himself has anointed him. My God has filled him with his love and set him completely free from every evil or every unbelief. And I started to pray this prayer. He didn't even know that I'm praying for him. But the whatever spirit was stopping him, or whatever that distraction was stopping him, that spirit can listen, right? So when somebody is praying and interceding for somebody, the evil spirit cannot have power on that person anymore. And it's in this year, in this month of May, it became now 1 year, we are both in the word of God. In the beginning he was not there. Now this month it's 1 year. And then one day came in last year, month of May, there was a retreat was supposed to happen in Ponda, and I told him, are you going to drop me or do you want me to go by my own transport? And one word he said, why you don't want me to come? Such a joy for me at that time, because that seed which I have planted, it grew and I got the harvest. So when we focus on ourselves, we started feeding ourselves. Now, what you said is, when somebody is continuing on sinning, they don't know the word of God maybe. Correct? Or maybe they know the word of God, but they don't live on the word of God. It can be two ways. Either a person keep on sinning because he doesn't know the word of God, and the other person knows the word of God but taking it for granted and continuing in enjoying his life. Yes or no? We see in the life of Simon Peter, and we can see the life of Judas. Correct? We'll take their example. Peter was, you know, quick in speaking, in action, yes or no, in straight, harsh statements, he was very quick in that, yes or no, and Jesus even rebuked him. Jesus even, get behind me, Satan, to whom he said? To Peter, yes or no? Now, Peter was a Satan, then why Jesus said, called him Satan? Jesus was not speaking to him. When Jesus was talking to them and telling the plan, what is going to happen, that the Son of Man has to go on the cross, you know, Peter said, I will not let this to happen. Now, this is the will of God, right? But who is coming in the middle? Who is speaking through Peter?
Satan.
The Satan. Yes or no? So when Jesus said, get behind me, Satan, he was not calling Peter Satan, but he knew Satan is speaking through Peter. Now, if Peter, being with Jesus for 3.5 years ministry, seeing all the things what Jesus is doing, but yet he was not yet there. He was not yet there. He did not understand at that time because he was in his physical senses. Are you getting it? Now, he is also, the difference what I'm saying is, he is also walking with Jesus and working with Jesus, and at the same time Judas was also working in the ministry of Jesus. But every time when quick response, quick answer, quick speaking, Peter is the one first.
And even I see in the written word of God, Peter is the first person who said it from his mouth that you are the son of the Most High God. He was the first person to say that. Even though he said, I will not let this to happen, but he is the one said, and Jesus said, flesh and blood did not reveal it to you, but my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. So without having the wisdom and the revelation from the Father, we cannot understand anything. But the desire should be there. Are you getting it? Now, in the outer page, it looked like that Peter is a person where he was very quick and he was fearful, where he denied Jesus for how many times? 3 times. But at the same time, there is somebody also walking in the ministry of Jesus who is called Judas. Yes or no? But Judas' thing is not outside. It's inside. Are you getting it? It's inside. So he planned to betray Jesus. But apart from Jesus, nobody knew this. Now why Jesus would know? Because of the wisdom, because of the knowledge, because of the revelation which he got and the connection from the Father. He said, whatever Judas was supposed to do, it was written in the old covenant. So it has to fulfill. Yes or no?
Yes.
So it's not that what outside what we are doing, but it is all inside what we are receiving. Now, if I am receiving the word of God, if I am walking in the word of God, if I am going for the retreat, listening to the word of God, and I have decided, Lord, let not my will to be done, but let your will to be done through me. So what happens to me? I am dying to my flesh. I am dying to my self. Yes or no? If I don't have any desire for myself, if I don't have any fleshly desire, my own selfish desire for myself, and I am depending on the Lord, it means I am alive in my flesh or I am dead to my flesh. Yes or no? We are dead to our flesh, right? So when we are dead to our flesh, are we going to count on what people are doing? Or are we going to count what God is speaking about us?
What God is speaking?
Yeah, but are we doing it?
No.
Where is our focus? On what others are doing. What somebody is doing. Yes or no? For example, when two neighbors are fighting, let's say, okay, two neighbors are fighting, and you know that they are wrong. You know that they are your side is right. But do, and she is putting all allegations, or they are putting all allegations, all blames on you. Okay. So now, if I'm in the word of God, can I keep on fighting and increasing the matter with them? If I do that, then what it will, you know, what it will benefit to myself? Like what would I say? Oh, am I leaving the word of God? Am I really dead in my flesh? Or my flesh is speaking? If somebody is fighting for the little, this much property, and they want to come in your side, okay, and they want to take it, and they are fighting for it, and they have already put a compound and taken your property, are we going to fight for the property with our physical strength? I'm not telling give away your properties to people, okay? I'm not saying that. If we are in that situation, because it happened in my family, in my life, many years it happened that they were coming in our side and all the fights were happening, arguments were happening, all of those things. But the day I came in the word of, and all problems were actually happening at that time, okay? They were throwing things in the side and, you know, those kind of things. And it was very hard to take it because it's not their side. So why they are unnecessarily doing and coming in our way and all of those things. When I began to continue in the word, right, the Lord is telling, be quiet. You are not of this world. You are not of this world. You're not going to take anything. So stop fighting. You know, the Lord actually spoke, not with the audible voice. You know, that inner witness comes, right? Stop it. And when things happened 2 or 3 times, I did not go there. I did not fight. I did not spoke to them. I just left it. And now what is happening, you know, they are good to us. We are good to them. And the place is just like that. But in before, whatever the person thinks, in his heart, so is he. So before what was happening, I was thinking about that. They're coming this side, they're throwing this side and the waste and this and that, you know, the waste rice and throwing this side. So I was very irritated. I was very angry at that time. But as I was growing in the word, now I have to take a decision. Am I leaving the word, or it's just I'm going and preaching and just I'm speaking the word? But if I'm not leaving, this Bible is not only for the knowledge, you know. This, the word of God, is not only for my knowledge. This word of God for me to live. Are you understanding? Yen devache utor ami jiopak jay. Understanding? So whatever the word says, whatever God is spoken about me, if God is telling me you are not of this world, you cannot have your own desire of this
you know, fleshly world, then how can I fight for that property, fight for the place? And when they are fighting also, you have to be quiet. That's what God's desire is there. And how we are learning this? From the life of Jesus itself. Because when Jesus was crucifying, he is the Son of God. Yes or no? Where he is sitting today? Where he is sitting today? At the right hand side of the Father on the throne. Yes or no? Today he is sitting on the throne at the right hand side of the Father. But did he ever said to the Lord, Lord, after I finish this, you take me and keep me in your right hand side on the throne, okay? Did he said like this to God? Did he put any condition to God? No, he only focused on the will of God in fulfilling his plan. And what was the plan of Jesus? What was the plan of Jesus? What is the plan of God for Jesus? To take the cross, right? To die on the cross. Yes or no? In Isaiah 53, we see how he was been crucified, how he was been put to shame, how he was been beaten up. All the whip he took on his body, his flesh was torn out, his bones were out of joints. Yes or no? Now he went through all of these things is because of you and me. So when these things is there in my mind, if I'm conscious about what Jesus has done for me, can I think about what my neighbor is doing and my family is doing and my relatives are doing, what my colleagues are doing? Because this mind, this heart is fully occupied with what? With the word of God. And what the word of God says, what Jesus has done for you and me. Now under the new covenant, the only thing on what I can live my life is to know what my beautiful Jesus has done for me. Because what Jesus has done for me, nobody could do for me. Are you understanding? That is called dying to your flesh. In the book of Romans 12:2, the word of God says, do not conform to this world. Do not conform to this world, but be you transformed by renewing of your mind. Yes or no? Okay, I'll read it. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, read.
Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect.
Okay. Do not be. Now, slowly. Because this is the word, this is the scripture, which really shows me what I am supposed to do if I say I am in Christ Jesus.
Do not be conformed. This world.
Okay. Do not be conformed to this world. What does it mean? How the world lives? Don't be with the world. So we'll go and stay on the mountain somewhere.
Means don't think the way the world is thinking, think as per the scriptures.
Okay, how the world is thinking then?
The world is thinking humanly.
For example,
you have to follow as per the word of God. How the word of God is doing.
Okay. Okay, let me read it in AMP, okay? And do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and custom, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually by the renewing of your mind. Renewing of your mind is focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes so that you may prove for yourself what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect in his plan and his purpose for you. So all the time, where is our focus? What plans I have for my life? What purpose I have for my life? Yes or no? Do we plan things?
Yes.
Do we plan things?
Yes.
We plan things? But are we sure that this plan is really what God has for me? And when that plan is not coming to pass, then what happens? Anger, irritation, disappointment, worry, or maybe fear. Yes or no? Some other translation says, don't be like the people of this world
But let God change the way you think, then you will know how to do everything that is good and pleasing to Him. Stop imitating the ideals and opinion of the culture around you, but be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Do not be conforming to this world means do not acting our life according to the world system. Then other translation we can say, don't change yourselves to be like the people of this world. How many times we are comparing ourselves to others? Don't we? Don't we compare ourselves to others?
Yes.
In any ways. If they have, even I should have. If they have this kind, I want to have better than that kind. If they have painted their house this year for Christmas, next year I want to color something better than that. Is it coming out of our own thinking or because somebody else has done?
Because somebody else has done.
We are comparing ourselves to others. Yes or no? There would be comparison. We would like to live like how people are living. Yes or no? If you if you present yourself differently and the world standard is there differently, don't they judge you? Look at her, she is little different. The way they are talking also is different. The way she is speaking also is different. Not like us. She is not like us. The other day, last week I can say, one girl, she is studying in school, okay? And she was crying. And I told her, what happened? What happened? Why you are crying? She said, nobody likes me. I said, why are you thinking like that? No, they don't like me. I said, why are you thinking like that? What made you think that nobody loves you? You know that Jesus loves you, right? She said, yes, Jesus loves me. And that same love, when I go and try to tell them, they are telling me, you are different, you are not like us, you don't play with us. See how it happens? Now, this girl is coming for a retreat. She's listening to the word of God. She's studying the word of God. She's studying all the words, the scriptures and all. So when she go and see her friends in the school, in the tuition, in the playing, in the neighboring wood, when she go there, she looking at how the children are, living their life, the language they speak, the dialogues they speak, they take the dialogues from the cartoons, from the programs, from the movies and all of those things. But when this girl is meeting with them, she tries to tell them about Jesus because she's learning that, right? So when she go and tell these kind of things to his friend, to her friends and in the school and in the tuition, they are telling her, you are not like us, you are different. You know why she is different now? Because she is renewing her mind. She is not conformed to this world, but she is renewing her mind according to the word of God. Now, when your mind is getting renewed, when you are not conformed to this world, people would say you are different. But did any time somebody came and told you all, you are different, you are not like us? Did anyone told yet? Did anyone told anybody like this yet? No. It means what? We are still conformed to this world. The day somebody would come and tell us, what happened to you? It happened with you?
Yeah. It's my workplace. Huh. Boss was just going on giving negative. And I every time whenever she is pleasant, I smile. Then one find is you are so different.
You are so different. This the world has to come and say. Then that time also I would be, I would be sure, oh, I am on the right path. Or I would say, Lord, you have
kept.
Yeah, that should be the Christian nature. The Christian nature should be like that. No back answering. Because when Jesus was dying on the cross, he did not open his mouth. If my Savior who died on the cross without opening. Now sometimes we love to talk. We love to talk too much. Yes or no? We talk too much. The talking is not the problem. The problem is what I am talking. The talking too much is not a problem. But the Bible also says, talk less, listen more. Yes or no? But we love to talk and talk and talk. But when we talk, when we speak, we need to be careful what words I'm speaking. I have to be wise enough with the wisdom from above to understand what I'm speaking. What words I'm taking out from my mouth. Because the words which I speak, that is going to decide my future. That is going to decide what is going to happen in my life. Are you understanding? It totally depends on what words I'm speaking, because whatsoever I speak, it's coming from my heart. Yes or no? So whatever is in my heart, it will come out from my mouth. Out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. Yes or no? So when those words are coming out, now even the heart, lot of things are happening in my mind, lot of things are happening, but God has given me the power in my words. If negative thoughts are coming, God has given me the authority to resist the negative thought by speaking the word of God and allow my mind to think on the word of God and speak those words which will edify myself, and my life will grow, and that's how I can make my future. Are you understanding? My future has to be not on what I am thinking. My future has to be on the word of God. If the word of God is inside me and I'm feeding myself, only those words are going to come out. Yes or no? Now, whatever I'm speaking, these words I'm studying, I'm speaking, I'm reading, I'm meditating. If I was not meditating on the word of God, do you think I would be able to stand here and speak the word of God? No. I would be speaking something of the world. But I would ask the Lord, help me not to get involved. No, don't allow me to be conformed to this world. And I can't do it with my effort. I can't do it with my self-ability. But the only Holy Spirit can give me the strength to keep me in the Word of God and allow me to be not to be conformed to this world. Because the world is waiting to deceive me. The enemy is waiting to deceive me. God has given me this life to be in this world, to save people and to save myself and live my life in the relationship with the Lord and on based on. Now see, Jesus came as a savior. Yes or no? Jesus came as a savior. But the savior is later, but first he is the son of the father. Are you understanding what I'm trying to say? The difference. Jesus came in this planet earth to save us. He came as a savior, but before that, he is the son of the father. He is having a relationship with his father, because he said, whatsoever I do, I see my father is doing the same thing. So whatever Jesus is saying, whatever I'm speaking, whatever I'm doing, I see my father is doing the same thing. Whatever I'm speaking, I see my father is speaking the same thing. So he was exactly imitating his father. And whoever seen me has seen the father. Yes or no? So Jesus was speaking everything about his father. Jesus was doing everything what God has planned for him to do. And because of that love, because of that relationship what he has with his father, he came to this planet earth to become as a savior for me, so that he could die on the cross and set me free. Hallelujah. But when we look at Jesus, you know how we are looking? Oh, we are looking at him. He is my savior, he is my redeemer, he is my deliverer, he created miracles for me, he has given me a power to speak to the mountain and the mountain will move, he gave me the authority. We are speaking all of those things which will benefit me. But did I ever take a point and take a thought to think that I would love to know like how Jesus loved me? And did I ever thought and take a pause and understanding the love of Jesus, how he loved me, and to have that relationship with him? So when children, I have taken the example of children in the beginning, right? When children comes and ask the parents to, you know, I want this, I want that, and they take the things and they go out. Okay, but now when the child is small, okay, when the child is growing also, if the child is not having the son or a daughter, when they grow up, when they become mature and they're not having a relationship with the father or mother, how the parents are going to feel? You have children big enough? Okay, if they come to you and if they say to you, Mama, I want this, I want that, that's it. And they take it and they go. They don't come to you and they ask, Mama, how are you today? How was your day today? They are working. When they go for work, when they come home, and when they don't ask, Mama, how are you? Morning, you were not feeling well, right? But how you are feeling today? They are not asking. They only ask you, food is ready? Okay, I want to eat. Oh, the water is hot already? Oh, I want to go and have a bath. Oh, my bed is already done. The bed sheets are ready. Oh, everything is ready. I want to go and sleep. If they only ask and not asking you, how are you? Not having that bonding with you. How are you going to feel? Broken? Hurt? Yes. But morning when they get up, do you think that, oh, last night he did not speak to me, she did not speak to me, I am not going to prepare any breakfast, let them go hungry. Will you do that? No, right? You will make. That is the love of a mother. That is the love of a parents. That is the love of a father. Yes or no? In the same way, our Heavenly Father loves us unconditionally. If I ask him, I want to get healed. In the name of Jesus, I command this mountain to go out and I receive my healing. He will give you healing. If you ask for the deliverance, he will give you. If you ask for the prosperity, he will give you, because he said Jesus became poor on the cross so that he could make you rich. Yes or no? And in the book of Philippians also it says that God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Yes or no? All my needs are met. I got healed. I got delivered. I got everything. And God will give you everything. Whatever you ask in Jesus' name, he will give you. But what about that relation? What about that bonding? When I go to my Father in physical, when Jesus comes for the second time, and when we all of us, when we go, how I'm going to be with my Father? What would be the relation? Can I only use Jesus for my benefits? Even the salvation we think, right? Oh, when I believe in Jesus Christ and accept him as my Lord, God and Savior, I would be saved. Oh, so let me accept Jesus. In that also, there is my benefit. Yes or no? When somebody is going for, somebody is going through some terrible pain or whatever it is, they would ask, tell me the scripture, which one I can confess so that I can get rid of this pain. My benefit. Yes or no? When somebody would say, I was going through a financial crisis and in lack and all of those things, okay, then please give me some scripture. And somebody would give 1 Peter, Philippians 4:19. And brother is writing. Praise God. So, somebody would give and I confess and I get what I want. Okay, my needs will be met, because the word is always true. Whatever you ask, you'll get it. But what about the bonding? What I'm speaking over here is relationship with the Father, relationship with Jesus, relationship with the Holy Spirit. I'm speaking about that. All I'm speaking is about the relationship with the Father, relationship with our Creator, relationship with the person who created me, who created this heaven and earth, who created this universe, who created these plants and the earth and the soil and the everything. Now, whatever we see, it's very beautiful for our eyes, right? When you stand here, you could see all the greenery. It's beautiful for our eyes. Yes or no? Who created? My Father in heaven created. But do I have a relationship with him? That's the question. When we fail to understand his love, or where we go backward to have relationship with him, is only when I begin to think about myself. It's only when I begin to think about myself. The place where I put me, that bonding is not continuing. It's not growing. It's stopping there. Because the day I started to consider myself, my needs, my time, my life, my family, my children, my job, my position, my salary, fail to build that relation with that Father who is giving me all of those things. Are you understanding this? Really?
Yes.
Praise God. So, when we put ourselves first, that's the time we miss. It's a very thin line, To be with your Father in his relationship, it's a very thin line. It's a very thin line. It's very subtle, You will not even realize that you are, drifting away. You will not even get it. It will look like I read the Bible. It will look like I go for the retreat. It will look like I'm listening to the Word of God. It will look like I'm going and helping others and giving the scriptures and doing all of those things. But in those things, I'm actually sometimes failing to have that relationship with the Father. For example, I can give husband and wife relation, okay? When husband and wife is there, wife is working in house and doing all the house things, okay? Washing, cleaning, mopping, cooking, different kinds of dish, everything she's doing. Whatever is needed to be done, she's doing extraordinary for the house, okay? And she's thinking, oh, if I do this, my husband will love this. So why she's doing? For the husband, okay? So if I do this kind of food, he will love it. He will be happy when he come tired from work. He will be eat and he will be happy, okay? She's cooking and cooking and cooking and doing all of those things. Now husband is working very hard so that he can provide to wife, yes? So is there a love? Is there a love? Yes or no? Because both of them thinking to make happy each other, right? So is there a love? Yes or no?
Yes.
Confused?
No.
He is working so hard, trying to do overtime and all of those things so that he can provide wife and she would be happy and she would buy whatever she wants. So is there a love? Yes. So she is also doing all the house cleaning. So when he comes home, he would see everything is clean. Ironing his clothes and hanging and doing everything. Whatever the best she could do for him. And very happy. So when husband comes, the children are also very clean and tidy and, you know, nice. So when husband comes, he's very happy. But when he comes home, now he is working hard to provide wife. Wife is doing everything so that she could make him happy. Yes or no? So both are serving each other in a way. Yes or no? But when husband comes home, he comes late because he is doing overtime. To do what? To provide her. Yes or no? So now he comes late. By the time he comes, he's very tired. Yes? He'll go to have bath. He'll eat the food, hardly talking, going to sleep. Because tomorrow again he has to go for office. Yes or no? Now both mindset is what? They're trying to make happy each other by providing things. Yes or no? But now in this relation, outside it would look like when they go outside, she is wearing nice clothes, expensive jewelry. Yes or no? He is also very happy taking her outside. But are they connected in their bonding? Are they together in their bonding? Is their relationship is stronger? But when people see what it will look like, they are very good. The husband is giving everything. She is very, when you see the wife and she is a housewife, people will praise to whom? The husband, because he is providing. Yes or no? So in outside, for people it will look like everything is going very good with them. But what about their personal relationship? What about their personal relationship? Exactly same is happening with us. We are trying to serve the Lord, go and preach here, go and preach there, go to this places, that places, and everything. All of our mind thinking of what? Going and giving the word. But are we really connected to the vine? Are you understanding? Are we really having that personal, intimate relationship with our Father, with our Creator? Getting it? Yes.
So, how do we have this? I get confused, you know, even when I get these messages around that we have to get into
relationships.
How do we get?
Okay. Now, how do we get? First of all, it's we'll go to John 14. Yes. Okay. In John 14, 26 verse you go. Okay. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Okay, let me read it in AMP. 14:26. Yeah. But the Helper, who is the Comforter, Advocate, Intercessor, Counselor, Strengthener, Standby, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, in my place, to represent me and act on my behalf. He will teach you all things, and he will help you remember everything that I have told you. Now when you see in 16 also it says, and I will, in John 14, 16 also it says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Okay? He may, in 14, 16 also it says, okay? He may abide with you. Abide with you forever. In John 14 verse 16. God will send you a Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit. he will abide with you forever. Understanding? Now, how to have a relationship with the Father? To have a relationship with the Father, it's not a system base. You know, there is no particular system. Oh, this, and then you are having a relationship with your Father. Understanding? The only way I can have a relationship with Jesus and with the Father is through Holy Spirit. Through Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Okay? See, in John 14:16 it says, and I will pray the Father and he shall give you another comforter. Now, comforter is the Holy Spirit, that he may abide with you forever. Now, without the Holy Spirit, I cannot understand God. I cannot understand Jesus. Without the Holy Spirit, my senses are working. Understanding? My physical senses are working. But with the Holy Spirit, I am operating in spiritual realm. Because Holy Spirit is the one who connects me in the spiritual realm, in the spirit. Hallelujah. So without the Holy Spirit, I cannot have a relationship with the Father. Are you understanding? Or with the Jesus? Because Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will testify everything about me to you. In John 15:26, it says. Okay, we'll read it. In 15:26, but the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. So when the Holy Spirit comes, he will testify me about Jesus. In 14th chapter we say, he will remind you whatever I have spoken about myself before. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, when I feed myself with the Word of God, when I study the Word of God, every time when I touch the Word, when I decide to study the Word of God, I have to be conscious, you know, that, ask to the Holy Spirit, Lord, with my ability, with my strength, I cannot understand this. I cannot get it. Because now, example we take about the life of Peter, right? Peter was trying to understand everything with his physical senses. Yes or no? Peter was in his physical senses where he denied Jesus for 3 times. Then he said, I will not let this to happen. Yes or no? He is the one who was rejecting all the time. When they come to arrest Jesus, Peter is the one who take the sword and cut the ear of the person who come to arrest Jesus. Yes or no? And Jesus said, put the sword in. And Jesus healed that ear. Yes or no? Because that's not the way. He was very quick. Understanding? He was very quick in action. It means he was operating in his flesh. It's not that he wants to harm Jesus. He is showing to protect him so that they will not come and touch Jesus. Yes or no? Intention is good, but with his physical senses. Are you understanding? So with the physical senses, we cannot understand the ways of the Lord. Understanding? We need the Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus said, tarry in Jerusalem. Do not go out of the city until the Holy Spirit come upon you. Yes or no? In the book of Acts, he said that. Yes. So, in book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8, he said, tarry in Jerusalem, do not go anywhere till the promise get fulfilled, till the Holy Spirit come upon you. Understanding? Now, why Jesus is telling, if without the Holy Spirit, if things could have been gone just the way how God wanted, then no need of Holy Spirit, right? No need of Holy Spirit. But why God gave the Holy Spirit? Because Jesus knew, without the Holy Spirit, we cannot do anything. Now, even if I want to have my relationship with the Father, with Jesus, without Holy Spirit, I cannot do it. Without Holy Spirit, I cannot do it. But if I want to have that relationship with the Holy Spirit, this logic has to be stopped. This mind needs to be stopped. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not be conformed to this world, but rather be transformed. Now, how to understand, you know, how to have a relationship? It's through the Word. The time when you will begin to start the studying the Word, ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, I don't want to understand this with my logic, because I know with my logic I cannot do it. It's very simple. You know, there is, for me, okay, I can give you my example. So, other people would come and give the scriptures for you, you know, this way, it's depend on how, on person to person, how they say. But for me personally, how I experience the presence of the Holy Spirit, you know, the understanding which I'm getting from the Holy Spirit, I can give my example because I'm experiencing that in my life. I have experienced and I'm still experiencing the very simple way how I go, you know, when I go to the Bible, when I touch the Bible, I said, Lord, before I open this word, before I get into the word of God, I'm surrendering myself to you. Allow me to understand with your wisdom, with your power, with your understanding, with your knowledge, with your spirit. Understanding? It's not with my senses. And I open the word and I pray, I open the word and I begin to read. When I begin to read and read and read, there are a lot, you know, it looks like the words are coming out. It's becoming real to you. When I read it, no, after doing that, every time I do that prayer, I said, Lord, I'm surrendering myself to you. You teach me, you guide me. It's not with my logic. Because when I began to, in the beginning, when I was studying the word, right, in the beginning, I was trying, and I was not able to connect. I was trying my best, you know, okay, I want to study this topic. I want to go to that topic. I want to go to this area. I want to go to that topic, you know. I was confusing myself and I was thinking that the translation is not enough for me. I want to have this translation. I wanted to have that translation. I want to do, you know, buy those book, that book, this book. I was confusing myself. I was confusing and I that time I did not know that is the, you know, the evil is trying to make me round and round so that I will not go to the word. Because any translation you take, in the end, it's the word of God. Yes or no? And it is the Holy Spirit who gives you the revelation, who gives you the wisdom and gives you the mystery out of it. Understanding? So I was confusing myself. And one day, I was so confused, super confused, that one day I said, I give up, Lord. One day I said like that, I give up. I can't do it. I don't understand. Help me, what I do? And it was not very long, few months back. I said, what I will do? I'm not getting it. And the Lord said, depend on me, rely on me, trust in me. Now what I was doing, if I have that book, I will understand more good. If I have that translation, I will get more understanding. If I have that kind of teachings, then I will get more understanding. You know what I was doing? I was depending on my logic. And that time I did not realize it, that I'm confusing myself and that is the trap of the enemy. I did not know what I was thinking, that if I get this, I will have more knowledge. You know, depending on whom? My knowledge. And I failed to rely on him. And when he spoke to me from my inner witness, he said, you depend on me. You don't need any translation. You don't need any books. You don't need anything. Whatever I have provided you, go with that and depend on me. I am the one who's teaching you. I am the one who's guiding you. In 1 John, I'll show you. In 1 John chapter 2 verse 27 you go. 1 John chapter 2 verse 27. But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you, and you need not that any man teach you. But as the same anointing teaches you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie. And even as it has taught you, you shall abide in him. Did you understand anything from this? John 2:27. See, but you have received, pay attention, but you have received the Holy Spirit and he lives within you. So you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know. Are you getting it?
Yes.
The Holy Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what he teaches is true and it is not a lie. So just as he has taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ. Yes. Now, in the previous verse we say, we read, and in this fellowship we enjoy the eternal life he promised us. And I am writing these things to warn you. John is writing this letter for us. And I'm writing these things to warn you about those who want to lead you astray. But he is telling, we don't need anybody. We need the Holy Spirit. We only need the Holy Spirit to teach us the truth, because He is the Spirit of truth. Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. Hallelujah. But you have received the Holy Spirit, and He lives within you. So you don't need anyone to teach you what is truth. For the Spirit teaches you everything. Now the guidance we would receive from the people where we go for the retreat, for example, from the preachers. But everything has to be confirmed with the scripture. I cannot come here and give you any teaching without showing the scriptures. And you all also don't have to accept anything without the scriptures. Are you understanding? So anything what we are preaching, what we are speaking, it has to align with the word of God, with the evidence showing it to you. Hallelujah. With the evidence showing it to you. So when you go home, when you open the written word of God, when you open the scripture, you have the evidence. Yes or no? So nobody can just come and say the bluffs and give a big talk and go, and without showing the scriptures, it can't happen. Yes or no? So it is the scripture, it is the written word of God. But the truth who confirms you in your heart, who convicts you in your heart, who teaches you the truth, is the Holy Spirit. When I started my journey, yes, I received the knowledge, the word of God from the teachings. But when I go back home, it is the Holy Spirit who was teaching me. Now, you all have come for the retreat, correct? When you go home, will you take me along with you all? No. But the only one person who goes with you is the Holy Spirit. Wherever you go, He goes with you. The only thing what I have to do is to surrender. To surrender and stop my logic. The only hindrance for me, the only one thing is stopping me to understand the word of God is my senses, is my logic, is my human thinking. God has given me the five senses. Yes or no? Who gave us the five senses? God has given. Now, God has given these five senses for us to live in this planet Earth. Now, these senses can be used only to live this in this world. But to understand the word of God, God has given me another sense which is in my spirit called faith. To understand the word of God is only faith is needed. The five physical senses will not work out in any ways to understand the word of God. And no matter maybe 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 year, maybe all of my life, if I'm trying to understand the word of God with my physical senses, I would not receive anything. Because why we are depending more on the physical senses? Because my eyes are showing me things. Yes or no? If I meet somebody yesterday and that person hallowed me and that person said, hi, how are you and everything. The next day I'm seeing the same person and then that person is turning her face and going away. What will happen to me? My eyes is showing me yesterday something. My eyes are showing me today something. Yes or no? Now, how I'll... What happened? Okay, no? Thank you, Jesus. By the wounds of Jesus Christ, you are completely healed. Yeshu ke koro se, ab changi ho chuki ho. Hallelujah. Okay. So, I was given an example, okay. So, today we see somebody, we see someone and that person hallowed us. And we say, hi, how are you, every neighbor. The next day I'm seeing that same person, she is ignoring or he is ignoring and avoiding completely. What happened to my mind? I began to ponder on what? Yesterday nicely hallowed, today what happened? Did someone told something about me? Is she thinking something bad about me? Is she going through something that related to me? So where is the focus? Me, me and me. Yes or no? And when this me come, how it entered? Through my physical senses. Yes or no? Through my physical eyes. Yesterday I see smiling face. Today I see angry face. So on that system, on that physical senses, when I see something with my eyes, my mood also is changing. Yes or no? And then my mood is changing, I'm getting into worry. I'm getting into anxiety. I'm getting into curiosity. Why it is like that? Yes or no? But God doesn't want me to know that. God only wants me to know that I love you no matter what. Regardless of who's talking to you, who's not talking to you, I talk to you every day. You come to me. Yes or no? So what I'm considering, what people are doing to me. Yes or no? But God did not call me for that. God did not appointed me to be in this planet earth to do whatever I want to do. In Jeremiah 29:11, it says, God has a big plan for me. He has a purpose for my life. My purpose is not to count somebody is hallowing me or not hallowing me. That's not my, it's not even important if somebody is hallowing, not hallowing to me. But when I remain focused on the word of God, that person might repent and come back to you. Because God can do anything. Yes or no? Nothing is impossible to God. Are you understanding? But if I'm trying to go on pondering on that, that's what the devil wants from us. No. Are you understanding?
Yes.
So this physical senses is given to me only to use in this planet earth to live here. Because if eyes are not given to me, now eyes are given to me so that I could see and I could walk carefully. Correct, no? Now if eyes were not given and if I'm trying to cross the road, what will happen? It can harm me, right? If I have my physical eyes, if my physical eyes are closed and I'm trying to, you know, walk in my house, can I walk everywhere? No. To walk around, what I need? Eyes. To walk around in this world, what I need? The eyes. But these eyes and this, looking senses should not control my mind. What should control my mind is the word. Are you getting it? What should control me is the word of God. Now, God has given me 5 senses. Now, why I'm saying that? Because of this physical senses, we are failing to understand the word of God. Are you getting this? Because of this physical senses. But that does not mean that physical senses are bad. Okay? That does not...
We need them
to be here. For example, if I don't listen, I'm sitting here. It will make any profit to me? No, right? If I'm standing here and I cannot talk, it will make profit for y'all if I don't talk? No, right? So whatever 5 senses are given is needful. Needful for what? To live in this planet earth. But that does not mean these senses should control me. Because the word of God, I cannot prove with my physical senses. The word of God, we could not prove with the physical senses. They are opposite to each other. Getting it? But when I decide to follow Jesus and to live my life according to the word of God, this senses has to be put aside. Are you getting it? Because the natural man will not receive anything. Are you understanding? In 1 Corinthians 2:14, I think it says, it's 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the people who aren't spiritual, okay, I will read it in KJV. But the natural man receive not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can be known them because they are spiritually discerned. In other words, we can say in other translation, but the natural man is called the unbelieving man, does not accept the things, the teachings and the revelation of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness and they are illogical to them. No, it's amplified. So amplified gives you the more detail. Okay, so the natural man, you know, when the man is person is becoming natural, when he work with his physical senses. Now for us, for a Christian, we are not supposed to live on our physical senses. When we, where we consider the word of God, when we study the word, when we live our life according to the word of God, we cannot consider our physical senses. Physical senses are only good to live, you know, to live, but not to control your mind. For example, if you are having a pain, if you are having any kind of sickness, okay, now body is telling what? You are sick. Yes or no? Body is telling you are sick. Now what you will consider? What you will consider?
I don't know.
Really?
Say that
you are sick. I will not stand.
Really?
Yes. It's
okay. Put camera on him and we record this part.
No problem.
He said, if I am sick, I will not consider I am sick.
I will say I am fine. On the contrary, I will say I am okay.
You will say you are okay. The body is telling you are in pain.
I will say I want no pain.
So you believe the pain, na, first.
I will not believe the pain.
You will not believe that there is pain.
No, I don't believe.
But you will have the pain, but you will not believe that there is pain. Okay. Okay, let me explain this. You have a pain, you could sense the pain, But you will deny believing that I have a pain, but I will believe that I don't have a pain. Correct, no? Okay. Everybody understood this? You have a pain, but you will deny that you don't have a pain. Scripture, you will say? Scripture is saying you are healed by the wounds of Jesus Christ. Okay? That does not mean we will deny the pain.
Pain is there.
For example, we are in this house, correct? If some dog is coming inside with all of that, what do you call that? You could say there are wounds and all of those things, and he's trying to come and enter somewhere inside. Okay? Now we are in the presence of God? Yes. But the dog is entered? But is he welcomed here? No. So you will ignore him?
Yes.
You will ignore the dog and let the dog go inside?
No.
You are telling yes, your wife is saying no.
I will drive him out.
You will drive him out, yes? Correct, no? Why you will drive him out?
Because wounds
and ugly and then dirty and some wounds are there. Yes or no? Not acceptable here, correct? You will drive him out. You will not ignore him. In the same way, you have to resist the pain. You have to command to the pain, but not ignore the pain. We are not supposed to ignore. If I cannot ignore the dog who is entering in the house and I will shoo the dog out, I will drive the dog out, in the same way, whatever is coming in this body. Now, is this body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Does the evil power can have power on my body? No. Can sickness can have power on my body? No. But if the sickness come, can I ignore and I will avoid the pain and I would say I am fit? But the pain is there. If we say pain is there, and if we don't resist, if we don't command with the authority, and if we say I am healed, I am deceiving myself. Because sometimes, we go extreme in the world, or we go completely low in the world. There is no balance. Extreme is what? I will ignore. No pain for me. But the pain is there. But I am saying there is no pain for me. If God wanted for us to be in that way, God would never said no, resist the devil and he will flee from you.
Yeah.
Now, what is sickness in the body? Is it just a disease or it's an evil? Okay. Go to Acts chapter 10 verse 38. Acts chapter 10 verse 38. Okay, read it.
Now God anointed and consecrated Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with strength and ability and power.
How he went about doing good
and in particular curing all who were harassed and oppressed by the power of devil, for God was with him.
Okay, I will read it here. Okay, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. So when the sickness come, it is oppressed by the devil, it seems. So he went on doing good and healing people who was oppressed by the devil. It means when a person is having a sickness, is it from God or from the devil?
Yes.
From the devil. So when the devil is operating in a body in the form of sickness, can we just ignore and avoid it? No, right? We have to resist him. But before resisting, we have to submit ourselves to God and we have to resist the devil, and then he will flee from me or from us. So it means we cannot keep quiet and believing that I'm already healed, but not commanding the sickness to leave. But we have to, because when anybody is coming to Jesus, when anyone who had come to Jesus, he said, be healed. Be healed. For the demon, for the deaf people also, he said, deaf spirit, come out. He did not say you are already healed. The deaf spirit, come out. Then the leper came to him and he said, if you are willing, you can heal me. And Jesus said, yes, I'm willing to heal you. And he said, be healed. Yes or no? He said, be healed. He did not say, you are already healed. He said, be healed. It means we need to command with the authority which God has given to us. Are you understanding? Just cannot ignore. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Sister, you got your answer about the relationship. I think we did not almost finish there, right? So it's the Holy Spirit. I went from here to there. So being in the presence. Okay. I'll show you one scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 13 verse 14. Okay, I'll read it. The grace of the Lord Jesus, 13 verse 14. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The grace of God. The grace what we receive is from Jesus. The love of God, the love we receive from God. And the communion is the fellowship. Communion is the fellowship. When we begin to have a fellowship with the sister, you have that verse, no? Because okay. What translation is that? NIV. Okay. So the communion of the Holy Spirit. So God wants us to have a fellowship with the Holy Spirit. So when we have a fellowship with Him, He is the one who will draw us close to Jesus. Are you understanding? If I want to build my relationship with Jesus, intimate relationship, I need to have a fellowship first with the Holy Spirit. Because He is the one who is drawing me closer to Jesus. If anything is not dragging, He will not drag you, I can say. He doesn't force you. He draw you. Drag is not a right word. Drag is forcefully, right? So draw you. He brings you closer to Jesus. Whatever you do in your life, you will find that something is bringing you to Jesus. Now, drawing you closer to Jesus is drawing you to the Word of God. Yes or no? For example, I can say every day when we study the Word of God at home, you know, even that 1 second, if I would get no from my work, I would run inside and I would read. Even little time I get, now praise God, God has given me a plenty of time. This past week I was really free at home, but even one moment, you know, that urge, you know, that desire was not coming that we could go somewhere and have fun and then all of these things. No, it did not come only. You know why? Because God, Jesus, Holy Spirit has controlled me. When we surrender, He controls you. It's effortless. But in my previous time, even little time, free time, if I get no, we would like to go out, you know, to go shopping or to go just like that. But now when I realize this is all waste of time, that same time I can study in the Word, right? I can be with my Lord. I can build my relationship with Him. And now somebody would say, no, we want to do it, but for us it is not happening. Me also it was not happening, but it is the Holy Spirit who is controlling me. Huh? Sorry?
Perseverance.
Yeah. You can say continue. You know, it's like, it's not by force. It's not by, you know, a pressure. There is no pressure. The time was free. Everything is there. If I wanted, could have just gone out anywhere. But it doesn't come only from inside. You know, when person, have you ever seen a dog? Dead dog. If you shoo him or light any crackers, he will run and go somewhere? No, right? Somebody has to take and put it. Yes or no? He's already dead. It means, can he have some desire or any will or any expectation for himself? Yeah. No, right? He's already dead for himself. In the same way, when you are not conformed to this world, as we have taken the Romans 12 too, when you are not conformed to this world, and your mind is getting renewed and you are transformed, you know, spiritually you are transforming. Who is taking the transformation place? Who is making that transformation in your spirit? The Holy Spirit. The Spirit is already new, but your mind is getting renewed now. And you know who is doing that? The Holy Spirit. And when He can do that? He can do that only when you take a decision to study the Word of God and remain in the Word of God. Remain, abide in the Word of God. Hallelujah. Are you getting it? So it is the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not our job. What I have to do is to have the desire. Lord, I want to know you more. That's all. I want to know you. And to show that excitement and that, you know, to show that excitement to him, to show that I really want to know you, you will just go home, you will take the Bible and you will just start reading it. You will just start reading it. The moment you start reading it, the moment you start focusing on it, the moment you show that, you know, you are hungry for it. When a person is hungry, how he is eating the food? You know, he doesn't care who is around, who is watching, because he is hungry, right? And if a person is not hungry, how that person will do? He's conscious, you know, he's conscious. He is not that interested in the food because he is not hungry. He is just eating for the sake of eating. But when a person is really hungry, that person does not care who is watching, who is looking, who is laughing, who is doing what, because that person is engrossed in the word of God. Are you understanding? Engrossed. Because the focus, the mind and the senses and everything is focused on the word. I want to know what my God has done for me. I want to know the person who has delivered me from the sin, who has cleansed me from every dirt. I want to know him more intimately. That will make us alive in the word of God. The intimacy will come only when you will be hungry and thirsty for him. Jesus said, no, those who are hungry, come to me. Those who are thirsty, come and drink of me. Yes or no? And when you drink of Jesus, you will be never hungry again. You will be never thirsty again. Yes or no? Hallelujah. So that kind of hunger should grow. I'm not saying that when you start doing it, people will start hating you. People will start judging you. They will speak about you. But you have nothing to do with them. Whoever may be speaking anything. When people are speaking bad about you, right? That's the good news actually. That is actually a good news. I consider that. When people speak about me bad. When people speak. For me, I count it as good, you know, when people speak about me. Because Jesus said, for my sake, people will insult you. People will persecute you. They will talk about you. Jesus said that. So when they are doing that, then I find myself, I am in a right relationship with the Father and not with the world. Are you getting it? But as a human being, what is our mindset? We want everybody to be in good relationship with me. They should speak good about me. Nobody should speak anything bad about me. Nobody should point me. Nobody should gossip about me. We want everything people to do good for me. You know, when I think like that, where is the focus?
On me.
So when I think about me, do you think I'm in relationship with the Father or on myself? Are you understanding? That's how I consider. When I began to understand people are speaking about me, I am rejoicing. Praise God. That I am in a relationship with my Father and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Really. For me, my experience, I'm telling you. It won't make me any difference. Rather, I'm more happy and I'm rejoicing. Because Jesus said it in Matthew. Okay, we'll go there. Go to Matthew 5. No, it's not my words, okay? Let's see. Jesus has said that. Matthew 5. 10 onwards we can read. Okay, I read it from here. Okay.
Yes.
Blessed are you when people persecute you for doing right. People will persecute you when you do right. Are you getting it? For the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Blessed are you when people mock you and persecute you and lie about you and they say all sort of evil things against you because you are my follower. So when you become Christ follower, don't expect anything good from others. Don't expect they will come and please you. Oh, you're doing wonderful job, nice sermon, nice preaching and this, that you're doing. You're very so lovely, you're so very great. They will say on your face. But behind your back, they will pick up your mistakes. They will speak about you. We don't know who is genuine and who is what. They will speak about you. They will gossip about you. And it is meant, Jesus said that. For doing good, he said, for doing right, people will persecute you. When you do right, people will come against you. They will speak all sort of evil things against you because you are my follower. And Jesus also said, if they treated the master like this, what about the slaves? What about the servants? Are you getting it? If they treated Jesus so badly, they persecuted him, they insulted him, they mocked him, they put him to shame, they spat on him, they hanged him on the cross. Did Jesus deserve that? No. And then he says, if they can do this to the master, what about the servants? But next what he says, but happy. Okay, I'll read in KJV only. Okay, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. But you rejoice. The 12th verse is telling us to rejoice. So when people come against me, am I supposed to sit and cry or to rejoice? So when people speak all evil about me, all lies about me, am I supposed to go and justify myself? I did not do it. I am not the one. Please don't blame me. I am innocent. I am like this. Should I do that? Or should I just shut up my mouth and keep quiet? If I want my reward in heaven, I am supposed to keep my mouth shut just the way Jesus was quiet, did not open his mouth and spoke even a single word in justifying himself. If my Jesus did not justify himself, who am I to justify myself? Who am I supposed to speak for myself? Because he said, rejoice and be, not only rejoice, he said, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. He did not even say rejoice, exceedingly glad. Are you understanding this? So when people come against us, what do? We go to the corner, sit and cry. Yes or no? But that's the time of rejoicing. But if I remain still focused on myself, I could not rejoice. I would cry. I would go and justify, or I would go and speak to people. You know, they did this to me. They are speaking. That's not the truth. But Jesus said, when these things are happening, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. So when people are persecuting and speaking evil about me, now this is the time to rejoice or sit and cry? And that's what I do. When people speak about me, it's not that I'm not getting to know it. I get to know it through somebody or the other. I get to know it. But then I dance. Because Papa taught us, when people come against you, you dance. That's the time I rejoice. That's the time I put any hymns and I dance. I don't want to go and justify myself to them. Because I know it's all evil thing will happen. All the gossip will come. People will speak about you, because that's what Jesus said. My God, my Savior has already spoken about it. It's not that something strange is happening. In the book of Peter also, he said, don't find it strange when people persecute you. It's not strange. It has already spoken. But that is only for a moment. That is not for eternal. Eternal is to be with God. The joy is eternal. The deliverance is eternal. But when you go through persecution, it is for temporary. It is like a testing of your patience, testing of your faith. You can say that. Are you getting it? But when little pressure comes from the world, little pressure comes from the family, when little pressure comes from the spouse, what do? We go into offense. Yes or no? When little pressure comes from your colleagues, from your friends, from your co-workers who's working with you, what happens to us? They did this, they did that, this problem, that problem. We are focusing where? On ourselves. Yes or no? In any place, in any circumstances, in any situation, we somehow or the other trying to find our comfort. You know? Somewhere, somehow, in some place, we are trying to find our comfort. When I try to find our comfort, no, it means I am living a selfish, a self-centered life. It's a self-centered life. It's not God-focused, because my Jesus said, people will persecute for surely. Persecutions will come for surely. You know, some people, you know, they get angry. When you will have a persecution, when they say that, why? If I'm following Jesus, then why should I get a persecution? Yes or no? Some people go in that thinking, you know, they go into anger, offense, or some, you know, they cannot accept it. when persecution comes, people cannot accept it. You know why? They say, if Jesus died on the cross and they persecuted him, then now why I should have a persecution? They finish off for Jesus, no? But that's not the word says. You will go through persecution. You will go through the trials. But in that trial, I have to be patient. I have to stand firm on that faith and focus, keep focusing on what Jesus has done for me. Keep focusing on that cross where Jesus is hanging for me. When I remain focused on that, I'm not focusing on myself anymore. Yes or no? The easy way, you know, even I go through this battle. It's not that I you know, it's everything is easy for me. No. I also go through the many battles when actually it's painful. When you get to hear people are speaking about you, you know, they're discussing things about you and not good, all bad. You know, they discuss nothing good about you, all bad. Understanding? So when I get to know those things, at a point, yes, it hurts. Because at the time, the focus is why they are doing what I did. It's all lies. It's not true also. But why? But when that why comes, no, the bonding which I have with the Holy Spirit, right, the inner witness will come. You are not supposed to focus on what people are doing to you, but you are supposed to focus on what Jesus has done for you. And Jesus himself said, so now is the time for you to rejoice. Now your promotion is near. Something is good about to happen. So if you go into offense, if you go into bitterness, you are stopping your promotion. So now the time for you is to dance and rejoice. To show the devil, it doesn't matter to you, whoever talks about you. Understanding? Hallelujah. Husband and wife should sit separately, you know. Then pokey pokey things will not happen. Just joking, okay? Hallelujah. Are you understanding? But when people come against us, what happens to us? We go and justify and then go and tell yes or no. But you know, that is all pride. And it's simple meaning that focusing on yourself and putting yourself first is pride. But Jesus said, submit to God. It means humble yourself. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus.
Focusing on self is pride.
Focusing on self is pride. How? Okay.
I think highly of myself.
Okay, explain, how do you understand pride?
Like, many of them are rich, but money, and they have pride, so they want to mix with others.
Ah, okay. The understanding what you have about pride is,
like people when, mix with the
other when they have the wealth, when they have, you know, position high, they don't get mixed with other people and they are in pride. Okay, they are in pride. They are pride because of the things what they have. Yes or no? Now, a poor person cannot have pride because he is poor. What he have to have pride in that? Correct? Like this you understand. Now, this understanding is the worldly understanding. Okay? Lucifer, what was his sin?
Pride.
Did he have a big wealth to have pride on it?
He thought that he was...
He thought he was bigger than God.
Say. He was pride because he have a wealth?
No.
He have property?
No.
He have bungalows? He have cars? He was thinking that I have everything of this world and you are small. So, okay, but now in the worldly system, how do we understand pride? When somebody is having the world wealth, the bungalows, cars, bank balance and all of those things, and then he is not looking unto the poor and he is pride. Yes or no?
Yes.
But did Lucifer has any of those things?
No.
No. But the Bible called him, he was in pride. Why is that? Because he was thinking he wants to go above God. Understanding? So where was his focus? I want to be on the throne. I want to be on the throne. Where is his focus?
On the throne.
On himself. No. He want to be on the throne means his focus was on his self. Now when his focus on his self, Bible called that he was in pride. So pride is not only that you have
yourself is a pride.
In a simple way, because from there it started. No.
Yeah.
Why he become Satan? Did God created him for to be an evil?
No.
No, God given him the wonderful, the music, he was playing the music, right?
Yeah.
Yes or no? So God has given him a kind of a gift. Yes or no? But in his mind, what he thought, I want to be above God. Yes or no?
Yes.
I want to be above God. I want to sit on the throne. Yes or no? Whatever he has given for man, I want it. Now what he has given for man? The dominion and the authority on the earth. Yes or no? God has given man the dominion and the authority on this earth. Yes or no? On all the creation. Now Lucifer wanted that. Whatever is given to man, I want it. I want to be on the throne. I want to be above God. So what is there? I, and I. So when the focus is on I, it becomes pride. And it's in a godly way. It's in a biblical way. Are you understanding? Pride. Now, can a poor person be in pride? No, right? But the Bible says even the poor person can be in pride. Can I explain how? Yes. When a poor person, he doesn't have anything. If he eats the lunch food, dinner, he doesn't have anything. Now what he is doing? Not depending on God, that God has supplied all my needs according to his riches, but he's saying, I am poor, nobody is giving me, nobody is providing me, I am like this, I don't have that, I don't have this. When he's saying, I don't have, where is his focus? On himself. So is he become proud or he is humble? If he is humble, he would said, my God has supplied all my needs according to his riches. My Jesus became poor on the cross so that he could make me rich. He has not having any understanding of the word of God, but he is blaming God and he is telling, I don't have this, I don't have that. So what does it become?
Pride.
It's become pride. A poor also can be in pride. A rich also can be in pride. A poor also can be humble. A rich also can be humble. A poor can show his humbleness by believing and depending on God and believing that God has supplied all my needs. A poor can be humble, focusing on God, and whatever riches he is having, he is giving it to the poor. Yes or no?
Yes.
Are you getting it? Even I was confused before when I did not know pride and humble. So if I get now, for example, Jesus said, right, when people persecute you, when they put you to shame, when they speak all lies about you and you have not done anything wrong, and now you're sitting in one corner and you're crying and you're sharing it to somebody, somebody would come and give you sympathy. No, don't cry. It's okay. God will show them. God will punish them and all of those things. And they try to comfort you. Yes or no?
Yes.
So when you are complaining what people are doing it to you, it will look like in the outside that you need a sympathy and you are a poor fellow. Someone says to come and comfort you because you are feeling very low, you are feeling very weak, and somebody is speaking about you, they come and give you the sympathy. It will look like there is no pride, there is humbleness, but there is a big pride there. You know why? Because you are focused on yourself and you are considering what other person has done to you. If I would see what Jesus has done for me on the cross, I would never focus on myself, and I would say just the way how Jesus said, if they have done to the master, what about the servants? Yes or no? Jesus never called us to go everywhere and justify yourself. No. And Jesus said in the book of Philippians also, it is written, I think in chapter 2, he said, God will judge who judges the just. He is my judge who judges the just. Just decision he makes. Hallelujah. Philippians chapter 2, I think, I'm not sure, but it's somewhere there. I have to check it. But God, Jesus never, the reason why I'm telling you that is, Jesus never opened his mouth. He waited on the Lord to make the justification. And to make it, take a just decision. He never opened his mouth. If my Savior, the only simple way we can understand is, if my Savior is not opening his mouth and justifying himself, then why should I? The very simple way. It's very easy. No more complication. If my Jesus is not justifying himself and telling them, I am the Son of God, if I want, I can finish you, all of you. Would have said, right? There are children, when their parents are, in some big position, they say, hey, you don't know my father. You don't know my mother. In what position they are, I will show you. I will, you see, in 1 week, in 1 month. They say that. But did Jesus did anything like this? You don't know who I am. Yes or no? It happens. But did Jesus did that? He was the Son of the Most High God who created the heaven and earth and the whole universe. Yes or no?
Yes.
He did not open his mouth. Then can I depend on the worldly standard and worldly position? Are you understanding? It is like, I remember one movie. I'm not going to take the name. It's what about the ship and the ship breaks. I don't want anybody to take the name, okay? So the ship breaks. And when the ship is breaking into two halves, people are holding the things on the boat so that they will not fall into the water. But they are not understanding when it is broken, it will go inside. But you know, we have seen in that movie, it looks like they are holding it to save their life, not realizing that together with that they are going inside. It's like we are holding the worldly things. Not understanding that the things which we are holding is perishable. In 2 Corinthians 4:18 we say the seen things are temporary, but the unseen are eternal. Are you understanding?
Yes.
2 Corinthians 4:18. The seen things are temporary, but the unseen are eternal. Now anything which we see in this world is temporary. Are you understanding? Anything which is in this world is temporary. It's for a moment. But the unseen is eternal. And what is unseen? The written word of God. The promises of God which Jesus has already fulfilled for you and me. What I need to do now is only to believe in what he has done. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. No, it's okay. Are you understanding this? So, if we are holding anything on this world, you know, a position, a title, you know, all of those things, these are all temporary. These are not going to take me to eternal life, to Jesus. These are all perishable things. What we have to remain focused is on the promises of God, what he has fulfilled for me. In the book of John 3:16, I have not finished the chapter, the verse. I think we have just taken the first line, right? God so loved the world. When he loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. When he loved the world, he gave something. He gave his only begotten son and he said, "Though whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life, eternal life." Those who believe in him. Now, believing in him is what? Not just believing. Keeping his commandments. Keeping his commandments. And what are the two best commandments what Jesus gave us? Love your God. Love your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and love your neighbor just the way you love yourself. These are the wonderful commandments, okay? These are the beautiful commandments. When you love your God, by default, you will love your neighbor as well. But if you don't have love for God, how will I love my neighbor? Are you understanding what I'm saying? Thank you, Jesus. And those who believe in Jesus will not perish but have everlasting life. So, but when I keep hold on the worldly things, do you think I'll be able to, believe in Jesus and keep his commandment if I'm holding the worldly things? No, because my focus is divided. I'm double-minded. And the Bible says double-minded person will not receive anything from the Lord. Because my focus is shifted. No, one side is my position, one side is God. So when I'm focusing both the side, what will happen? What will happen? I'm either not in any of the side. Because double-minded person will not receive anything from the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody has any question? Shall we all stand? Let's close your eyes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Just keep your eyes closed and just see Jesus on the cross. Just see Jesus on the cross. Whatever may be the distraction which is there in your life, offer it unto him. Because he said, cast your burdens unto me. Cast all your worries, cast all your cares unto me. He is ready with his arms wide open to receive all your worries and your cares and your problems and your sickness and your disease. Everything, he has taken it on the cross. Whatever may be the distraction, Holy Spirit is taking control in those areas. Any area in your life which you are not which you are not able to surrender to Him, this is the time. Lord is waiting with His arms wide open to receive whatever is hindering you, troubling you. Give unto Him. Give unto Jesus. The only one thing God wants from you is you. To have a relationship with you. To have that bonding with you. That close relation where nobody can enter between you and Lord. No matter what has happened in the past, no matter what has happened today morning, the Lord is filling you with His power. The Lord is filling you with His Holy Spirit right now. The power of the Most High God is upon all of you right now. Experience His presence. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you right now. The Lord is filling you with His Spirit. The Lord is filling you with His Spirit. Let the Lord take care of every emotions which is tormenting you. Let the Lord take care of every hurt that is troubling you in your heart. Give it to Jesus right now. Give all the hurts, all the pain, all the rejection which you receive, give it to Jesus right now. The Holy Spirit is there to help you. God has given you His power. God has given you His wisdom. God has given you His strength, His knowledge to know Him more and more. Let that relationship of you and the Lord grow more strongly. Any kind of bad habits, any kinds of bad talks, surrender to Lord. Let the Holy Spirit transform you from inside out. Let the Lord do His job. But your job is only to surrender. Give your life, give it to Him. And let Him give you His eternal joy. The Spirit of the Lord is upon each one of you. The fire of the Holy Spirit is upon you right now. Holy Spirit, fill them with your power, with your fullness. Let them be drunk in your Spirit. Let them receive you right now, O Lord. Lord, fill them with your power right now. Let them experience you. Transform their heart, O Lord. Make it like Jesus. Let the love of God flow in their hearts in so abundantly. Holy Spirit, take complete control of their lives. As they are surrendering themselves to you, O Lord, you take control. Pour out that love of God into their heart. Fill them with you. Let them experience that fire upon them. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your presence in this place right now. As we are gathered over here, we have studied your word. We believe, Lord, that you are here in our midst. We might be very few, a bunch. But we believe that you died for us and you have given us a new life. Help us, Lord, to surrender completely ourselves to you. Help us, Lord, to allow that your will to be happen in my life, in our lives. As we have studied your word, we believe, Lord, that you have started working in our heart. As we have received your word as a seed in our heart, thank you, Lord, for helping us to water it every day so that it will grow in a big tree and give a multiple harvest for ourselves as well as to the others who is around us, in our family, in our workplace, and wherever we go. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence. As we carry your presence, wherever we go, we carry this joy, we carry this happiness, we carry this freedom. As your word says, where there is Spirit of God, there is freedom. Right now, there is freedom in this place. Right now there is freedom in this place. Every bondage is broken right now. Every chains are broken right now in the name of Jesus. Every demonic spirit, leave this place right now in the name of Jesus. The Spirit of God is moving in this place and filling us with God's love. The Spirit of God is moving here and feeling in your heart the God's love. Father, I thank you. Father, I praise you for all your goodness, for getting these people in this place, O Lord, because you know what they are going through. Thank you, Lord, for touching their hearts. Thank you, Lord, for filling them with your power, with your love. Lord Jesus, thank you for transforming them and renewing their mind and making them just like you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.